Gas Station Business 101 Podcast. I'm your host, Shabir Hossein, and this is episode number 17.
Welcome to the one and only Gas Station Business 101 Podcast, where you can learn all the secrets about how to start and operate a gas station business successfully and make money. This podcast is brought to you by the good folks at CSB Academy Publishing Company. And now, here is your host, Shabir Hossein.
Hello there. Welcome to the Gas Station Business Podcast Show once again, and thank you for joining me. Today is the second part of adding 5 mini businesses to your existing gas station business series. In episode number 16, which is the last episode, I touched on how to add income by adding mini businesses such as vape shop, novelty items, wine, cigar, and movie rental to your existing business and generate extra sales and, in return, extra profit. And I believe I emphasized on vape shop because I have done wonder with vape shop, and I'm sure you have seen many stores around you that are doing well by selling vaping products and accessories. But one word of caution before you jump high and spend a lot of money or invest a lot of money into this, remember, vaping and this sort of things are in style right now, but if you're listening to the show, let's say 3 years from now, it may not be in style, and maybe there would be some new things instead of vaping. So be careful not to spend too much money at the beginning. Start slow. I mean, when I say slow, means start low with low investment, but and see how it does in your store. If you have a lot of vape shops around your market, you may not do as well. Or if you're in a rural area where there is no vape shop, you may do very well. But before you jump very high and invest a lot of money, do check into this sort of things. And then make sure you don't have too many back stocks because regulations on this sort of things are just about to come out right now. And as we speak, I read something in the newspaper locally here in Alabama that the state of Alabama is going to add a tax on e-liquid as a tobacco substitute. So there will be a tax imposed on it beginning of 2017, which is, I believe, it starts January 1st, 2017. So your state, your city, your town may have similar laws that are coming about. So do check into those as well. And this way you will be prepared beforehand and you don't have any issues with taxes and all that. Just like previous episode where I spoke about those 5 items or mini businesses or ideas of mini businesses that you can add to your existing business, I will be adding 5 more today that you can think about. And again, before I get into that, remember, these 10 items are not where your limitation is. You're not limited to just these 10 items or these 10 ideas. These 10 ideas may give you another 10 ideas, related ideas, or you may come up with a totally different idea. As long as you try something, if you never try, you will never know what is good and what is not. Our goal is to be creative and open your creative side of the brain. So these 10 ideas, once you start thinking about these, you may come up with something totally different and be very successful at it. So that is my goal, to open up the creative side of our brain and see if we can come up with something unique that nobody's doing and it's completely legal. And once we do it, we see success and at the end of the day, we make good money. That is our goal, to make profit, make money. Now, the ideas that I will be talking about today, the very first one, we all know this. This is not something very creative idea. Most of the gas stations or convenience store already has it. And I'm discussing this topic because I have done it in many stores and I've seen very good profit. So in case your store does not have it, you may want to think about this. And the topic is deli food. Well, this is a gas station. I've always had deli. I mean, if you look around your neighborhood or your town and city, there are many stores that have deli and there are many stores that do not. And there are some stores that do not want to have deli. They're not equipped to have deli. They're not big enough to have deli, and that is fine. And if they're profitable without deli, that's even better, because at the end of the day, your labor cost is very high in deli. So if you have a profitable store without deli, that means you're doing pretty good. But let's say you have a big store or enough room to have a deli and your sales are mediocre, then why not try something and see if that would bring you quite a bit of extra business? Because I have seen that in my business many times where the sale, let's say in one typical store I can think of 7-8 years ago, the store is a big enough store, has had room for deli, but it never had deli. And the sales were right around 60,000. And when I took the jump to have deli, I spent quite a bit of money setting up the deli. But in 4 months after opening that deli, our sales were right around $90,000. So you see, deli doesn't just only sell food, it brings people into your store. So if somebody is buying some food, they're naturally, they will be picking up their beer, soda, cigarettes, and other stuffs along with that. So it's like a restaurant. Your lunch rush, there is something called lunch rush in a store that has deli. If your store doesn't have deli, there is nothing called lunch rush. So that is something good to have, because right around 11:30, quarter till 12, you get ready for that rush. And again, it feels good to see a line of people coming in, buying food, buying other stuff, and the store parking lot is full. So this idea only applies to people that have a store with decent enough room that they can spare to have deli. Now, since I have done deli in many, many stores, I will talk about a few things that you need to think of before you jump too high and spend any money to get the deli going. Couple of things you need to keep in mind. One is, first thing you need to do is check with your health department, local health department, because every health department is different. When I say different, means the requirements can vary from state to state. So it is a good idea to check with them at first and say, listen, I'm looking to open a deli in my store, inside my store. So what are the requirements as far as the health department is concerned? And most of the time, they will hand you a list of things, a laundry list of things, such as you have to have 3-compartment sink, you have to have a mop sink, you have to have hand sink, you have to have dumpster pad with running water, you have to have vent hood. I mean, there are lots of requirements. So you need to see if some of these are doable in your store. And if they are, how much they will cost you. If, for example, say to get a deli going in a store, which I've seen in one of my stores, I got an estimate from a contractor for $120,000. And I did not do it because to me, spending $120,000, I might as well buy another business instead of spending that kind of money to open a deli where I'm sure I would not sell a couple of $1,000s of food every day. Maybe it's going to be $300-$400 a day at best. So I did not do that. So what I'm getting at is it is a very good idea to check with your local health department and see what kind of requirements they have for you to open that deli, and then talk to a contractor or some type of people that can do this type of plumbing work and other type of work and get an estimate. And then you will know if it is within your budget or if it is something you don't want to do. Now, once you realize that, okay, I can fulfill the requirements from the health department. Let's say you already have a 3-compartment sink and mop sink and all that. Then you need to see what kind of equipment you may need to open your deli, because that is another expense you have to go through. And for example, most of the deli sells fried food. So you have to have some fryers, which are not very expensive. A fryer, unless you have a very fancy fryer, most of the gas fryers cost around $700-$800. But there are fryers, pressure fryers, that can cost as high as $3,000 to $4,000. But let's say you don't want to go that high, you will do well with just a regular gas fryer that runs on natural gas or electric for that matter. And they usually cost anywhere from $700-$800, which is not a big expense. But the problem is, when you have a fryer, you also have to have a ventilation hood or vent hood. And that is where the expense comes in, because you have to hire a licensed contractor that has to cut open your roof, part of your roof, to install that vent hood. And that ventilation hood exhaust creates, works as an exhaust to get that smoke and the grease smell out of your store. So it is an essential thing to have, and the health department will require you to have that. The fire department will require you to have that. So it is something you have to have, but this is where your expense comes in. So you need to check and see if that would cost a lot of money or not. I have seen as high as $30,000 to install a 16-foot vent hood. So, and again, you may not need 16-foot of vent hood. You may be fine with the 4-foot vent hood. And if that's the case, it may cost you maybe $3,000, $4,000, $5,000. But it is a good idea to check. Now, some of the stores, if you bought an existing store, it may already have a vent hood. If that's the case, then your job becomes much easier and less expensive. So again, it depends on your situation. You need to go through these steps where you check off, say, I have checked this and this will cost this much. I have checked this, cost this much, and see if this falls within your budget. Next, space requirements. Remember I was talking about, if you have a big enough store, you don't have to have a 5,000 square footage store, but at least you have to dedicate some space for the kitchen area where the fryers will be, where the vent hood will be, where the three compartment sink will go. And you do not want to have your customers look at what you're doing in the kitchen. So there has to be a wall of some sort that keeps it away from the customer's eye, because the kitchen is not always very clean or very pretty. So you do not want to make your customer view what you're doing. So essentially, it has to be done in a back room, so to speak. If you have a back room, that's good. Then check, see what you have in that back room and what kind of plumbing is required and what kind of electrical service is required. Because also, you have to understand, when you install all these machineries and equipment, you also are going to be using a lot of power. So your store has to have enough power source and supply and service to handle that demand. So that is another thing you have to have, which is, let's say your store doesn't have deli and runs on a 300 amp service. All of a sudden you're adding oven, you're adding fryers, electric fryers and vent hood. All of a sudden your service requirement goes to 500. Then you have to change your electrical box, upgrade that to 500 amp service. And again, that costs money. So these are the things, again, you need to check very carefully. And that is why I suggested you check with a contractor, licensed contractor, who may have an electrician, a plumber, and a roofer to give you estimates, so you can add all those and see if it is something feasible for you to do. Once you work all of that out and see that it is feasible for you to do and it is within your budget, next you need to decide what food to sell. When it comes to deli, it depends what food you should sell. It depends on where you're located at. Again, if you're in the city, your food choice or your selection would be slightly different than if you're in a rural area. But again, if you have a good cook and if you look around your neighborhood, your area, your city, you may find what is popular and what sells better than others, and try those. Couple of things to remember. Not every type of food has long shelf life. When I say shelf life, I mean in when you put, cook the food, you put it in a deli case, hot deli case. I'm sure you have seen those deli cases with lights in them. And you put the food inside the deli case that keeps it warm. But remember, not all food can be in a deli case and taste decent. For example, shrimp. If you fry shrimp and put it in your deli case, within after 30 minutes or so, the shrimp will not taste anything like it was when it was just fried. So similarly, there are a few other things that changes its taste quite fast, rapidly, I should say. So you need to know what food to cook and what not to cook. If it is made to order, you can cook those any type of food all day long. But for example, you make a sandwich, let's say turkey or ham sandwich, and you put tomatoes, lettuce, onion, and all of that. You cannot put that in a deli case for 20, 30 minutes because lettuce, tomatoes, onion, these are vegetable, fresh vegetable. So when you wrap that in a bread with cheese and meat and put it in a deli case, what happens is the water from those vegetables starts getting into the bread and makes the bread soggy. And pretty soon, you can hardly eat that sandwich. So similarly, you need to be very careful and see what you should cook and put it in a deli case and what you should not. So let's say if you have to cook some type of hamburger or sandwich or something, don't put any fresh veggie when you put it in the deli case. When you take it out of the deli case before you serve, you can add those veggies and then serve to your customer. Now, the last part on deli would be what to price your deli food. When pricing deli, if you have never done deli, just remember it is not like pricing your candy bar or your cigarettes or beer. Deli is completely different. Restaurant business and deli is not like convenience store. And what I mean by that is when it comes to pricing, let's say you buy a egg roll. It's a typical food for deli. You buy an egg roll from a food supplier for 50 to 60 cents. Typically in a convenience store setting, what we do is if it's a candy type items or grocery type items, we mark it up to 30%, 35%. In this case, we're not doing that. Instead, we're going to go mark it up over 50%. So if you're buying it for 50 to 60 cents, your selling price should be right around 119 to 129. Because when you are doing it as a deli, your profit margin, remember in restaurant settings, in most restaurants, the food cost is not very high. When I say not very high, I don't mean you buy it much cheaper. What I mean by that is food cost is typically between 20 to 25% of your total sales. And your labor cost is usually about 30% in a restaurant setting. So you see, food cost is only a fraction of the total setup. So, but in a reverse way, if you look at a gas station, let's say you sold $1,000 worth of beer. It's your cost of goods sold or the cost of buying that beer wasn't 20%. Was more like 80-85%. But in restaurant industries, their food cost is only 20-25%. Then they add all the other fixed cost and all that other cost and labor cost, and that's how they get to the 100%. So when you buy food, you buy it at a raw form. I gave you an example of egg roll. That is not a raw form, but let's say you're baking a pie and you're buying your flour, your sugar, your butter, your milk, all in the raw form, and then you mix it up and you make your pie. So the pie may sell for $10.99, but if you add those cost of those ingredients, they may only come up to $2.50 or $3. So essentially, you should be selling for what, $5.99? Because you paid, your cost was $3.50? No, not in restaurant setting. So again, similarly in deli setting, you will be cooking chicken, you will be cooking rice, you'll be making different types of dishes like lasagna or meatloaf and whatnot, and chicken with gravy, chicken with rice. But see, you buying all those ingredients at a raw form. So you're paying much less, but then you mix it up and you create a meal out of that. So there is a cost involved in that. The labor and the power, the oil that you're frying it with, the gas, other utilities that are associated with that. But again, if you have no idea what to price your food, best idea would be to go out around your area, look at the other delis and see how much they're pricing their chicken, their pies, their lunch specials at, and then look at yours and look at your food cost and make sure to keep enough gap. So if you sell, let's say, $200 of the food, at least you don't lose money, because deli's break-even point is much higher because, again, a lot of labor, a lot of other costs are involved in running a deli. So my calculation, the way I do it is, if I have a deli in a store that requires a cook and a server and whatnot, the deli has to do over $450 for me to make money. Anything below that, I get into a break-even point or below break-even point, means I lose money. So depending on your setup, you may be breaking even at $300. But again, if you are going through a lot of expenses to open a deli, let's say you spend $30,000, $40,000 to start a deli and your sales are only $250 a day, then I would say that is not a good idea to do the deli. As long as you know your sales would be $350 or higher, then it is worthwhile to invest whatever you will be investing, your time, your money, your effort, then you need to go ahead and do that. But for you to know for sure how well you will do, you can even start a mini roller grill and see how people react to food. I'm sure you know about roller grills. You see it in every 7-Eleven, every Circle K. They have those hot dogs and other type of roller grill food. And if you see a good response from people, then that's a good indication that people are willing to eat the food that you serve in your store. So do a mini testing and see how people respond. Then take the leap and invest your money into a deli. But make sure when you do it, have a nice menu to go along with it. Maybe you can even provide people with a phone number, say they can call in and order. And one good thing to have in a deli, if you have the room, set up a oven where you can cook pizzas and people can call in and order their pizzas and pick it up. And there are a lot of franchises that are available for almost free. Your grocery company or your food supply vendor can hook you up with some of these free franchises. A pizza franchise, what I meant. And all you have to do is buy their pizzas and bake it and sell it. And they make the money by selling you the product, and you get to use their name, their logos and whatnot. But the good thing is you will be selling a semi-branded type pizza, so you don't have to invent how much sauce to go, how much sauce to put on, how much toppings to add and all that, because it's going to come prepared most of the time. And if you can pick the right one, you may have a good pizza business. And that is not something to laugh about, because I have looked at it. If I can sell 10 pizzas a day, that makes me more money than, say, selling all the candy that I sold for that day, because it's a high profit margin item. And if you bake the pizza that already came prepared in frozen form, not much labor involved. All you do is unwrap it, put it in the oven, it comes out, cut it, put it in a box, give it to your customer. Let's say you bought the pizza for $350, $375 when you bought it from your food supplier. You sold it for $9.99. That is a good chunk of profit. So look into that when you're doing the deli. Do it the right way and you will be successful. Now, number two on that list is fresh fruit. I'm sure some of you or all of you have walked into a store, a gas station, a truck stop or a convenience store, and you have seen either on the counter or a counter somewhere next to the checkout counter where they have some bananas. Some stores I've seen even carries apple. So when I first saw that, I started thinking I need to buy a nice looking three-tier fruit basket that I can put next to the checkout counter. And I started looking and I found one. Bought it. It was expensive. It was almost $250 because it has wheels. It's a little bit nice. It's not just a small basket on the counter because I didn't want to clutter up my counter. But once I started buying these bananas, even from grocery stores or fruit stand, bananas cost only, 50 cents a pound or similar to that. But when I started selling, I realized that people usually sell them at 99 cents a piece. If you look closely, you will see that is a high profit margin item. Even though it's perishable, means you buy bananas today, 3 days later, they're going to go bad. So don't buy hundreds of them. Try with 10, 15 and see how many you sell. And by that, tweak it and figure out how many you have to buy every 3 to 4 days. So you don't have much waste, but you will make good profit. And if you see you're selling the bananas, add other stuff like apples. I do sell apples and they do sell very well. And then I started adding oranges and other fruits, whatever I can get my hands on. Not strawberries and those type of things, but I'm talking like pears and different types of oranges and apples. And I carried like 3 different apples right now. And they do sell well. So you need to look into carrying fruits, fresh fruit, with a nice looking handwritten sign that says 99 cents. And you will have some extra profit, extra income just from that fruit. Because every morning, a lot of people, when they're going to work, if they want to eat healthy, they may just get a banana. And that is a good thing to have in the morning because it gives you energy, it gives you potassium. And like old days, people used to say, apple a day keeps the doctors away. And a lot of people still believe in that. And it is good for your health. So a lot of people still take either a banana or an apple in the morning or in the afternoon for that matter. So it is a good idea to carry this product. And as long as you carry it in a nice, presentable way, you will be selling those things. So invest in a nice display rack and carry the nicest looking bananas. Don't buy the small ones or the ones that are turning dark already, black already. Buy the healthy ones, the big size ones. That way people will feel good when they pay 99 cents for a banana. Because the guy or the person who's buying it, they also know they can go to the grocery store and buy 5 bananas for a dollar. But in your store, they're paying for the convenience. So make sure that they're getting the product, the nice product for their money. So give them a nice looking banana that are healthy looking, no marks, no nothing. So be careful when you buy those. Now, number 3, we're going to move away from food. As I told you in the last episode, that the last 3 items will be all about financial items that can add revenue to your business. Most of the stores now already have ATM machines. This is our number 3 items on the list. It is ATM machine. And maybe you already have one. But the question is, do you operate the machine or you, somebody, other company operates it for you and shares revenue? See, when I first started in this business, there was no ATM in gas stations. And then last 10, 12 years, I've started noticing that ATMs are becoming more and more common in gas station settings. And then a company came and offered to share revenue with me. At first, they offered 30% and I was happy. I didn't know how much money an ATM can make. I was getting $200-$300 checks every month and I was happy as I can be because that's an extra revenue for me. Then 3-4 years ago, another company came and said, listen, I will give you $1,000 sign-on bonus and I will share 50% of my profit with you. By then I started realizing that this is a very lucrative market. And I took that offer. And I started making $700-$800 a month. Then exactly 2.5 years ago, I opened a new store and I put an ATM machine by myself. I got a company to sell me an ATM machine, which I got a service from another bank. And I was charging, I believe, and I'm still charging $2.50 transaction fee. And I started noticing that I'm making $1,700 to $1,800 just from that machine. I'm not sharing revenue with anybody. But again, that shocked me that all this time I was losing that revenue by sharing profit with somebody else when an ATM machine only cost $2,500 to buy. So if you gather your 2 months profit, you can buy a brand new ATM machine. Why would you want to share profit with somebody else? So if you have a machine, look into it. Who do you have your service with? If you have a contract, how long the contract is for? And if you have to give them a notice to cancel the contract, read through those. And if you can, get out of those contracts and get your own machine and make your own money. Only work that you have to do for this is you have to add money physically to that machine, which now, if you have a company that shares revenue with you, most likely that company sends somebody to fill the machine. But in this case, when you own your own machine, you have to fill that machine with your money. But don't worry, the money comes back very next day. As soon as the people withdraw from your ATM machine, that money gets deposited into your account very next day. So there is no delay. Only positive thing is you get to keep $2.75 each time somebody uses that machine. Other than if they check balance and do not withdraw, you don't get anything. But not very many people go into an ATM just to check balance. So if you get 10, 12, 13, 15 transactions a day, which is very normal for most convenience stores, you'll be making at least $1,000 a month. And that is not a small amount when you think about it. It will cover almost half of all your utility bills if you have a normal size store. Now, number four is money order. Okay, money order, a lot of people may get scared thinking, I don't want to deal with money orders. But I recently took a store, when I say recently, it was a year and a half ago, where there was money order. And at first, I thought I would take the money order out. But within 7 days, I realized that money order is not there for you to make money on. See, every time you sell a money order, you make 75 cents, 85 cents, 95 cents to a dollar, because you cannot charge more than a dollar to sell a money order. People will not buy it. But the sweetness of this is when at the beginning of the month, if you're in a neighborhood where there are a lot of apartments, a lot of these people, when they get paid, they come get a money order to pay their rent. But more importantly, they spend their money in your store, not only to get money orders, but to buy other things, because it's a one-stop shop. And a lot of apartments nowadays do not accept checks from a lot of these people. So they have to get money orders. And not only apartments, not only rents, there are a lot of people that pay their utility bills and other bills with money orders. So anytime they need money orders, they will come to you and spend money on other stuff, buy other things. So it is a good income generating, passive income generating machine, literally. So if you, and it doesn't cost you anything to have that. It's a small machine. They can put it on your corner of your countertop. It doesn't have to be on the front. It can be on the back counter. As a matter of fact, I prefer it to be in the back counter. And it will just sit there in 2 square foot space, and it will generate quite a bit of income for you. And again, it will be most of the time passive income, meaning people will come to get the money order. And once they get it, they will do other shoppings as well. So it is an added bonus, and it will not cost you a dime to have that machine. Then why not offer that to your clientele that, hey, I sell money orders as well. And for you, there is another added bonus to have money orders, which is vendors. If you have vendors, which every gas station, we have vendors. We pay our chips, our Coke, our beer, and everybody else. Instead of you writing checks, and as a matter of fact, nowadays, most banks charge most of the commercial accounts based on how many checks and transactions you do. So let's say you write checks to every vendors, and at the end of the month, you see the bank charged you $75, $80 for a couple of hundred transactions, because every check is a transaction. Instead, if you give them money orders, you don't have to worry about if that check will bounce, if the check got cleared, if there was an issue with the bank. Give them a money order. That way your bank will not charge you a transaction fee, and you will make sure your vendor got paid on time and with the right type of tender, meaning there is no bouncing money orders. So you will not have to worry about, hey, you know, did I make the deposit or is my check gonna bounce? A lot of times people worry about that. And if you give out money orders, you don't have to worry about that because money order people will EFT your account once a week, maybe twice a week. And as long as you know those two dates, you can cover those with your deposit and not worry about the small checks that you're writing every day to your vendors. So think about that. It has many benefits, doesn't cost you a dime. And the last on that list is, again, related to money, is check cashing. Well, a lot of you may think, what is he talking about? Well, check cashing may not work for every store. If you are in a very nice part of the town, check cashing may not be a good thing. But if you are in a place where there are factories, there are offices, there are places where a lot of the blue-collar people get paid, a lot of these people do not have bank accounts. So what they do is they go to the check cashing place or to a local convenience store. And this is where they cash their check. And usually, typically, most check cashing place charges between 1 to 2% of the face value of that check. So let's say somebody brings in a $500 check and you charge 1%, you make $5. Not big deal, but you make $5 cashing that check. Again, you're taking certain degree of risk because whoever wrote that check may not honor that check, means it may bounce. But there are systems nowadays, there are check systems nowadays that you can implement and that will guarantee that the check is good. All you have to do is research your area and see who provides the check care service for check cashing places in your area. Another way you can do it, which I've seen a person that became very successful doing check cashing, they have three big companies around them that are factories, have hundreds and hundreds of people working, and they only cash those three companies' check, and they got registered with those three companies by saying to their accounts payable that, hey, we're the company that will cash your check, so make sure you see us as a vendor. And somehow they understood that and they had an agreement between them, and they gave them a list of employees that they pay every week. And if anything changes, they fax them a new list saying this person got terminated, so you will not see a check from this company or this person. So they had an updated list every day, and every week they cashed about $100,000 to $150,000 of the checks. And for a decent-sized check-cashing place, that is not much money. $100,000, $150,000 is not much to cash in a check-cashing place. But again, if you're charging 1%, that's quite a bit of money. But more importantly, what do you think people do once they cash that check? Do they take all the money home? No. They will turn around, buy their beer, buy their carton of cigarettes, and all the other stuff that they need. Plus, next day, they will still come back to you because this is their place to cash check and buy their stuff. So think about it. There are some risk involved. There are two risks. One is a check from an unknown company, if you cash, can bounce and you lose that money. But remember, there are recourses for bounce check. You can file at DA's office. You can fill out a form and file a claim, and most of the time, DA can collect that for you. But I know we're not in business to go to DA's office every day and say this many checks bounced and whatnot. But once you know the companies that you're dealing with, chances are very low. Plus, there are, as I said, systems in place that you can install, and that would ensure that you're cashing the good checks only. Second risk is you're carrying a large amount of cash in your store. Paychecks don't get cashed every day because people only get paid on certain days. It could be Thursday, Friday, or it could be Monday. But whatever day in your area people get paid, you have to make sure you have certain amount of money in your store to be able to cash those checks. So let's say the demand is about 100,000. You have to make sure you have 100,000 cash dollars in your store. So the risk is big when you know that you're carrying that type of cash, and if the bad guys know that you carry that kind of cash every week. So there has to be a good, solid, safe system, plus video surveillance, plus alarm system, and all of that has to be in place to safeguard that money. And you have to have some type of office setting where you can only do check cashing through a window and people do not walk into that office. So it has to be a lot of security measures that you have to take into account and install, for that matter. But again, it's worth looking at it if you are in an area where there are a lot of factories, a lot of blue-collar workers that are working, then you can investigate and see if it is feasible for you to do so. Now, let's recap. First, we spoke about Delhi and the requirements for Delhi, which is health department requirements, equipment requirements, space requirements, and whatever modification you need to do to that building that you're in, that has some requirements as well. And then you decide what food to sell and what price you should sell your food for. Next, we talked about fresh fruit and how you can carry fresh fruit in your store and make some decent money. And then we spoke about ATM machine. And again, you may already have an ATM machine, but you need to see how much money you're making, if you're splitting profit with somebody or not. And if you have it on your own, then you're all set. Number four, we spoke about money orders and how money orders can bring more business to your store. Number five, we just talked about check cashing. And again, I did mention the risks that are involved and associated with check cashing, but also the benefits and the rewards that come with check cashing. Now, time to answer the emails that I did not answer last week. The first one came from a person named Bipin, and he asked if I could clarify the difference between profit markup and profit margin. And he says he read it, and he read it on Google and all that, but he wants to understand how that is applied in C-store or gas station. Bipin, first of all, thank you for your question. I apologize for not answering your email last week. But since you said you already read about the differences, but you're still confused how that applies to a convenience store or C-store setting, the best way I can put it to you is, let's talk about a candy bar. Let's say you buy a Snicker bar for $1, and then you sell it for $2. Now, how do we calculate profit margin? We calculate profit margin by taking the selling price minus the cost, which is $1 in this case. $2 is the selling price, minus $1 is the cost. So we get $1. And now we divide that by the selling price. Selling price is $2. So if you divide $1 divided by $2, you get 0.5, which is 50%, because 0.5 is the result, and anything you get, you just put in a percentage to it. So it is 50%. But if it was, the result was 0.15, that would make it 15%. Since it's 0.5, it's 50%. Means you're making 50% profit. So just remember this. Anytime you want to find out what is the profit margin of any product that you sell, you take the selling price, subtract the cost of that product, and then whatever the result you get from that subtract, you divide that by the selling price, and you get to your profit margin. Now, let's look at the same example for markup. Let's say, again, you bought that candy bar for $1, you sold it for $2. So you take selling price minus your cost, which is $1 again. Your profit is $1. You bought it for $1, you made $1 profit, and you sold it for $2. Now, this time, instead of dividing it with your selling price, you're gonna divide this by your cost, which is $1. So in this case, $1 divided by $1 is what? Is $1. That means you're making, your profit markup is 100%. So you see, the difference is huge. And if we get confused, it can literally ruin our business, because we may be thinking about profit margin, but we're calculating markup, and we're saying, hey, we're still doing 25 or 30%. when you're literally doing 10% or below. So make sure and remember to divide your difference by selling price always and not by your cost, because that's not what we calculate in our business. We always calculate profit margin and not markup. I hope I was able to clarify that for you. If not, if you have any more questions, please feel free to email me once again. Now, the second email came from a person named PK, and his question is about fuel delivery discrepancy. He said after a fuel delivery, often he finds the net gallon does not match his gas reading on his Vitaroot or his measurement device that he has in his store, and what he should do about it. PK, this is a common problem for most of us. And we spoke about in a previous episode where I talked about fuel delivery and where I spoke about gross gallons versus net gallons. And if you recall, I spoke about why there is a difference. It's usually based on temperature of the day and where you are. If the temperature is high, the difference will be higher because gasoline and fuel is measured by volume. So when the temperature is high, the volume rises. But in your case, your Vitaroot or the measuring device that you have in your store is registering slightly different than what your bill of lading net sales says. Let's say the driver wrote that they brought 8,000 gallons gross and the net is 7,950. So there is a 50 gallon discrepancy between their gross and net. But don't worry, because you only get billed for the net gallons and not for the gross gallons. So you will be billed for 7,950. Now, once the fuel is delivered to your tank, your Vitaroot or your measuring device spits out a report, or you can run a report that says gallon added or increase. It will say volume increase, and then it may say volume was increased by 7,940 gallons. Then there is a 10 gallon difference. Well, it is within the margin of error, because every one of these measuring devices measures it by a probe that's set in the gasoline tank. And then you have to understand, when the gasoline is being dropped from high above from the truck to the tank, it drops and it raises the temperature of the tank. So the volume may show higher or lower depending on the temperature of the day. So if it's a cold night, it may shrink lower, and it will show a negative. Means if your net gallon says 7,950, it may show 7,920. And again, if it's a hot day, and once the gasoline is dropped, your net gallon may say 7,950, but your Vitaroot may register 7,970. So again, it is within the margin of error, but you did not specify how much of a difference do you see. Again, if your difference is over 100 gallons, then I would ask you to address it with your delivery driver or your jobber, because there might be other problems and you need to investigate that further. But if it is within 20-25 gallons, you can pretty much assume that that is within the margin of error, and don't worry about it. So hopefully I was able to answer your question. But again, remember this, PK, if the difference is higher, let's say 100 gallons or more, then you may have a potential problem. And again, you need to check into that very carefully. One thing you can do is, next time the delivery driver comes in, make sure check first, see if it is the same driver that comes every time. And next time he comes, stand there with him, make sure he drops the whole gasoline to your tank, and then go take the reading, match it with him. If not, show it to him, say there is a difference. And one more thing you can do, which I do in this type of cases where I know the difference is huge, I take a stick reading. Stick reading means, I'm sure if you're in this business, you used to have a measuring stick in the back of your store where you stick the tank with. And if you are new to the business and don't have a stick, you can buy one of those for $20, $30. Remember, before Vitaroot or before any of these measuring devices, we used to measure how much gas we have every morning by sticking a stick into the tank and registering that inch, and then taking that inch, let's say I stick my tank and see that I have 27 inches of regular gasoline. How do I know how many gallons is that? Every tank comes with chart, fuel chart. You take that inch to that chart and see 27 inch means maybe 3,300 gallons or something like that. So we used to do that, and that is the most accurate way to measure fuel. Your video root can go crazy, your probes can be out, your probes can be out of calibration, and it can register wrong readings. It can give you wrong readings. The best way, when you have this type of discrepancy, get a stick reading and measure it with your chart and see exactly how much fuel was delivered to your tank. And this way, you don't have to worry about if your measuring device or video root is accurate or not. And time to time, you can cross-reference this just to make sure that your video root is giving you the right reading. That is very important to do, and which I recommend you do once a month, just to make sure that the machine is doing its job properly and you're getting the fuel that they're saying that you should have gotten. So very important to do that at least once a month. Well, we're at the end of the show today. So the book that I usually mention every week, I mention a book and I recommend a book that I read. And this week, the book that I want to mention, every one of you, I'm sure, know this name of this writer. But the name of the book is How to Win Friends and Influence People by Dale Carnegie. Growing up, we always heard this name because this is a legend when it comes to self-improvement and that type of things. I remember my grandfather even told me once, say, you need to read Dale Carnegie. Anyway, I'm sure you know about Dale Carnegie. And he's the grandfather of all people skill books. And this book was first published in 1937. But it was an overnight hit from the get-go. Eventually, I read on Amazon that this book sold 15 million copies. So you can imagine there is something to this book. And since people and human nature do not change, that means even though he wrote it back in 1936, not much has changed when it comes to human nature. So you can still read this book and you can get a lot of benefit out of reading this book. I have read it and I recommend highly that you do too. Once again, thank you for joining me in this episode. And I am late publishing this episode because I got busy doing something else, and I do apologize for that. So any of you that are waiting for this episode, I know I was supposed to publish it at least 3 or 4 days prior to what I'm doing. So again, my sincere apology. Send me an email if you have any question or any comments, and please do not forget to sign up for my newsletter. Take care, and I'll talk to you soon.
This has been the one and only Gas Station Business 101 podcast with your host, Shabir Hossein. This podcast was brought to you by CSB Academy Publishing Company. Be sure to join us next time as we share with you the secrets about how to start and operate a gas station business successfully and make money.